I will make you as many perfumes as you want, but you have to teach me how to capture the smell of all things. Can you do that?
Well, naturally.
Then teach me everything you know. And I'll make you the best perfume in the whole world.
Last time on Essential Viewing Collection, we reviewed The Collector, an intricately woven, haunting fairy tale where we learned that sometimes we find love in the most unexpected of places, and that everything isn't always as it seems.
That's incredibly insightful. We also learned that serial killers tend to keep collections of trophies from the people they murder. Sometimes it's a blood sample, sometimes it's the people themselves.
You take one down!
And sometimes it's their very souls.
Your soul is mine.
How does one go about collecting a person's soul, you ask? Well, this is a lesson the anti-protagonist learns in Perfume, the story of a murderer. And through him, you too can learn the fine art of distilling the scents of beautiful young virgin girls.
The soul of beings is their scent. You said that, Master.
Perfume is the film adaptation of the 1985 novel of the same name by Patrick Susskind. It tells the story of Jean Baptiste Grenouille.
What is your name, anyway?
Jean Baptiste Grenouille.
A sociopath with an incredible sense of smell that decides to create a lady-scented perfume using all natural ingredients. This story of fascinating obsession remains the second best-selling German-language novel of all time behind Remarque's All Quiet on the Western Front. The film's producer and co-writer, Bernd Eichinger, was a personal friend of Susskind's and had been trying to secure the film rights since the book's first publication.
When I read the book, I told myself, this is my book and this is my film, and I want to make this film.
Susskind finally relented in 2000, and the film was released in 2006 to a critical reception that's criminally, you might even say, murderously poor.
You may not know Bernd Eichinger by name, but you know him by reputation. He's the guy who wrote all those Hitler Reacts To memes on YouTube.
Sie nennen sich Generale, weil sie Jahre auf Militärakademien zugebracht haben, nur um zu lernen, wie man Messer und Gabel hält.
Those are some award-winning memes, and it's a pity their success didn't transfer over into this movie.
Perfume, like Prometheus, Red State, and The Collector, is not the movie it appears to be at surface level. Being a period piece set in 18th century France, you'd expect the film to be much ado about the affairs between lords and ladies in the states of their estates. If you aren't a 50-year-old woman or a youngster with a 50-year-old woman's taste in made-for-TV drama stories, this may sound quite boring to you. Luckily, Tom Tykwer, the film's director, feels the same way. Said Tom, I find so many period films boring, so my aim from the outset was to make one that was really modern in terms of film language, but still remained true to its historical obligations, in the same way the novel's modern narrative is never sacrificed to its historical accuracy.
Perfume starts like a Charles Dickens story in the same vein as David Copperfield or Nicholas Nickleby.
In the period of which we speak, there reigned in the cities a stench barely conceivable to us modern men and women.
Jean Baptiste Frog, or...
What, you're calling him a frog because he's French? Don't be so culturally insensitive.
Grenouille means frog in French.
Oh yeah? Well, okay. Uh-huh.
Jean Baptiste Frog, orphan the day he's born in the fish market, grows up in an orphanage where he's disliked by all the other children for having an extraordinary sense of smell and using it to be weird.
It was not that the other children hated him. They felt unnerved by him.
The orphanage's owner apprentices him to be a tanner, where he's abused and beaten every day. Grenouille perseveres, survives into his 20s, and makes it to the city of Paris. This is usually where the main character would naively fall in with some ne'er-do-wells who promise to help him make it in the world, but not before catching a glimpse of some lovely maid he vows to make his bride.
The movie takes a sharp twist when Grenouille accidentally kills a young woman whilst accidentally creeping on her in a dark alleyway where she lives. He didn't mean to creep on her, he just wanted to smell her up close.
Jeez, lady, take a compliment.
As her scent fades with her death, Grenouille resolves to search for a method to preserve people's scents so that he will never again lose such a beautiful smell to unintentional suffocation.
This leads him to once great perfumer, Master Dustin Hoffman.
I have to learn how to keep smell.
What?
Can you teach me that?
I shall have to think about it. Now go.
What would the world be like without Dustin Hoffman?
What would the world be like without
Dustin Hoffman?
He's a very good actor and a flamboyant personality, but also someone with the necessary dignity.
He's a very good actor and a flamboyant personality, but also someone with the necessary dignity.
We have a deep love for character actors, actors that manage to steal the show for the short time they're on screen, and Hoffman steals the show in the short time he appears in Perfume.
Stop! Stop it! That's enough! Basta!
You know nothing! Essential oils are always to be mixed first, then the alcohol added, and never ever is perfume to be shaken like that. I must have been insane to listen to your asinine gibberish.
The filmmakers wanted Hoffman's personality and reputation to contrast with Grenouille actor Ben Whishaw, who was, at the time, not in a mega-million-dollar piece of pretentious crap, and therefore unknown to the movie-going public. Said Tom again. Although there were many willing actors, it only really seemed plausible to choose someone for this role who was completely unknown. You could also say a nobody who was to become a somebody, because that's what the story is about too. With these two, we had the perfect constellation. On the one hand, the icon of the modern Hollywood movie, and on the other, the unknown talent who is about to break loose, which also fits in nicely with the plot of the film.
Because talent means next to nothing, while experience acquired in humility and hard work means everything.
No less show-stealing is a masterful performance by Alan Snape.
Last night I dreamt you were dead.
Severus Rickman plays Antoine Rishi, the only person in the story with any sense in his head.
Of course, a curfew is necessary, but we also have to catch this man, and the only way to do that is to understand how he thinks, what he wants.
Unfortunately, he's just as obsessed with his daughter as Grenouille, and this leaves poor Laura Rishi caught in the middle of a battle for her possession.
Papa, what's the matter?
We're going home, now!
But why? I'm enjoying myself!
Don't argue with me,
Stop
Laura!
Stop it! I'm grown up!
With Rickman's trademark nasal line delivery, it almost sounds like they chose someone with no sense of smell to counter Grenouille's exceptional talent.
Game's over, everybody! Laura! Time to go in now.
The best part of the whole movie is a scene where Rishi delivers a hate-filled speech to Grenouille before his execution that only Alan Rickman could deliver.
We're not spoiling anything. The movie starts with the announcement of Grenouille's execution.
The speech was basically written for Rickman to give, as he was the only actor offered the role, and it's perfect in every way.
I will look deep into your eyes and drop by drop. I will trickle my disgust into them, like burning acid, until finally you perish. Mr. Potter.
That scene alone is worth the purchase price of the movie.
The biggest challenge of adapting the novel to film was that the main character doesn't ever express himself. How do you show a character's growth if the character is a cold, unfeeling sociopath? The narrative solution was to narrate the character's development, which may not be the most novel idea.
Oh man, you said that.
But it's expertly executed by John Hurt, who was pretty much born to narrate.
When Jean Baptiste did finally learn to speak, he soon found that everyday language proved inadequate for all the olfactory experiences accumulating within himself.
This narration takes a few liberties with the story, giving Grenouille more character growth than the book originally had. Usually, this is detrimental to the story, but in this case it helps us to understand Grenouille's motives and therefore become more invested in the film than if they'd copied the book directly.
The way we did it, he doesn't really mean to kill her. It's kind of like an accident. In the book, he does mean to kill her.
That's an important point in the film, one of the cornerstones of the drama.
Said Bernd, Grenouille acts without any idea of ethics, but also without any love, any feelings of responsibility or human grace. You would not see a character like this in 99.9% of regular movies, so it's not a question of identifying with him, but rather of understanding his motives. We needed to write this character in a way that an audience would be fascinated by his obsession. If you can understand his obsession, you're into the character and the movie.
Of course, to be truly invested, you have to accept a few ridiculous ideas, chief among those being that there could be a person whose sense of smell is 10,000 times better than a dog's, and that young virgin girls smell better than a new car full of old books parked on a freshly mowed lawn. If you can suspend your disbelief that far, you'll have no problem.
Counterbalancing the story's more unrealistic aspects are the film's realistic depictions of everyday life in dirty, filthy 18th century France. Actors were instructed to wear their costumes throughout the production to give them a sweaty, lived-in look. The production crew had a dirt unit of about 60 people, giving all the sets an extra layer of grime.
There was always the question of how far we should go with the filth. That's something that never usually needs to be considered. And suddenly we had a whole department, and its job was creating nothing but filth.
Even so, Perfume is a gorgeous film. Even managing to make garbage and filth and gross, sweaty French people from the 18th century look beautiful. It's meticulously lit and colored, starting with cooler tones and getting warmer as Grenouille enters the world and acquires more sense. The lighting is sparse and shadowy, reflecting the story's dark tone and the lack of electricity, typical of backwards countries like 18th century France.
You are being racist, I knew it!
As if you people had electricity in the 18th century.
What do you mean, you people?
The soundtrack is just as gorgeous, written by the director himself during the writing of the script. This ensured that the music would complement the film perfectly, as feelings written into the score would come out of the script and vice versa. The soundtrack, like the story, is a scent trail in the air, leading you to what you think will be a beautiful conclusion that turns out to be quite the opposite.
Perfume is as fascinating as it is suspenseful, right up until the stupid ending, which will probably make you change your mind and pan the movie after your first viewing. This same thing happened with us. We all hated this movie the first time we saw it because of the ending, and it wasn't until the second viewing we came to appreciate what the movie was trying to do. Trust us, the movie is much, much better the second time through.
Perfume, the Story of a Murderer, is one of the most fascinating films about murder ever created, and we are fascinated to call it a part of our essential viewing collection, a list of movies we think should set the standard and fascination for all movies henceforth.
Don't get us wrong, the ending is still a load of crap, but we learned to accept the ideas it was trying to communicate and ignore the method it chose to communicate them. It's how the book ends, after all. If you look at it that way, it's easy to keep the ending from spoiling your enjoyment of the rest.
Of course, there will always be those people who do enjoy the ending, and if you're one of those people, then you're probably one of those people who likes Ellie's backstory and Let the Right One In. And that's weird. It's okay, we still love you, even though you're weird, and you like weird things.
You smell nice, though.
Yeah, of course. You people smell like nice people.
What do you mean, you people?
Feiglinge! Verräter! Verräter!